concerned about our city. As I've looked around our city over the last several years, I see missed opportunities, crumbling infrastructure, poorly maintained parks, and streets on which our citizens don't feel safe. Mobile is at a crossroads. The most troubling indicator of what lies ahead for Mobile is our declining population. While similar cities like Charleston and Savannah are growing, Mobile is shrinking. Right now, our city's most valuable export item is our young people. Our children graduated from high school and college can't find opportunities in Mobile. They are leaving to find jobs in other cities and the quality of life that they seek. This has got to stop. The leadership at City Hall has settled for mediocrity, but our citizens will not. We know that we can do better. It is time that we have a mayor who listens. It is time that we have a mayor who gives priority to hiring the talent and the ingenuity of local individuals and companies. It's time we had a mayor who quits telling us reasons why we can't do things. And finally, it's time that we had a mayor who represents everyone, regardless of what neighborhood they live in. So let's set our goals high. Let's stake claim to a bold vision. Let's set a course to become the safest, most business and family-friendly city in America by the year 2020. We can do this through servant leadership, true transparency, collaboration with the city council. We will unite Mobile from Tillman's Corner, Dolphin Island Parkway to Trinity Gardens, downtown through Midtown to Spring Hill, and into West Mobile. When we do that, we will be one Mobile.
We will continue to have a lot to be proud of. recovery of the economic downturn than any city in the country. Even with the economic downturn, and I'm talking about cities outside, even with the economic downturn, we have been able to stabilize our community, provide quality services to every citizen, and have not had to do anything like laying off employees.
Could be, and by the way,
Our statistics were not based on what was found. The reporting for that era was not even complete yet, so it's not been reported.
Your time is up.
Reason is
is that we're not doing anything to solve the problem. So yes, perception is a crime is a problem, reality crime is a problem.
Seconds.
vibrant, livable, walkable downtown. But if you don't have a safe downtown, you'll never have it evolve into what you want. And so when you think about young people coming back to town, and a lot of places where they live, off the farm or whatever, they would like to walk to work. They want bike paths. They want walking paths. Now they want, and there needs to be family entertainment down there. But you've got to feel safe in doing that. And so I am very much about improving downtown, and everything that the city and the city council can do has got to be done.
So we can't just say we're going to stop it. We've got to grow it. And the only way we can grow it
situation as if the people, as I said earlier, that migrate out of the city really migrated to the police jurisdiction. So they still get those same city services. You say that they're worried about crime? The same police department is who serves around them. They don't have anybody else to serve from the Columbia Police Department. So crime is not the issue. It's certainly not emergency medical service.
That's where the money comes from.
how do you plan to meet those problems?
The major budget problem is the economy has to stand down, the local economy. It is not stabilized since we had the downturn, the massive downturn in the economy. We're moving back to where we need to be. When we, in 2008, we had an unemployment rate of 3.6%. In 2010, we had an unemployment rate of 11.2%. That rate now is about 7.9. Until we can do something to address that, then we won't have any stability in our revenue base. And we are about to address that. We have spent 7 years trying to make sure that we got the kind of industry here to provide the kind of jobs we can address the unemployment rate. I think in the next 3 years, you'll see us grow to a point where we won't need the 1 cent sales tax. We won't need a lot of other things because we'll have enough people working and bringing in income, but we'll see our retail sector, and basically for cities, the retail sector and automobile sales and those type sales are what bring in revenue to cities. The cities get the ad valorem tax, but the bulk of ad valorem tax goes to the school system and the county. That's why I said we need to equalize that sum. But our basic source of income for any city in Alabama, with the exception of Birmingham, because they have a lot of patron tax, is sales tax. And we can actually see that change when we affect our unemployment rate and see our economy grow.
Can't fill openings fast enough because of employment turnover.
What are your plans to remedy that situation?
I think that one of the primary reasons that we're losing police officers has to do with what they're being paid. And it's like the other things that I have mentioned, where does the pay going to come from? It's going to have to come from generating additional revenues, or it's also going to have to come from reorganizing and reassessing the priorities. When you lose 50 policemen a year, that's almost equivalent to a precinct. And we've been losing 50 policemen a year for about the last 4 years. We have 5 precincts. So if you want to get on a trajectory of what can happen to crime, when you have police officers, you know, where 40-50% of the force are less than 4 years old, you know, you can figure that out. And so we have got to figure out a way to give policemen a raise. I mean, if we don't do anything else, we have got to do that. We cannot be the training ground for Daphne and Spanish Fork and Sarah Lane. But it's not just the pay that they're leaving for. It's the work conditions. It's the environment that they're working in, the pressure they feel because of different things that happen, about being required to do certain things. And so that comes back to leadership, and it starts in the mayor's office. And I guarantee you, the policemen will understand that they have a friend in the mayor's office, somebody that will champion their cause day in and day out, whether it's night or dark. Day or dark. I look forward to working with our police officers.
Going to to do it, and over the next few years, you will see thousands of jobs that these young people can come back to. For years, they've had to go other places. I have grandkids. I don't plan for them to leave those people. I plan to continue to work as hard as we can to build these companies in Mobile, whether they be small business or industry, or whether they be service companies. We have to have a combination of all in order to bring those young people back, in order to attract professionals to Mobile, and I think we're on the road to doing that. I think everybody here knows we're on the road to doing that.
As someone who left the area for college and came back after graduation, I feel that it's important for Mobile to do everything possible to lure our young people back to the area. As mayor, what would you do to promote this city for young professionals to return and start their careers?
In an earlier debate, the mayor made a comment that Mobile had led the state in economic development over the last several years, and it's true, we have created over 18,000 jobs, but we're not growing as a city. Many of our young people still are not coming back to Mobile, and it's about the quality of life. There's another city called Oklahoma City. They decided they weren't going to change economic development anymore. They were going to change the quality of life. And when they changed the quality of life in that community, then people would want to live there. And when the right people live in the community, then the businesses will come. We have done a great job between the Mobile Chamber and the state of Alabama of attracting TK, and we've done a good job of attracting Airbus. But that does not solve our problems. We have got to focus on quality of life. And we've got to do the things that the young people want. They want roads with bike paths. They want jogging paths. They want a vibrant and growing arts community. You know, they want to have an incubator system for startup companies. They want it to be business friendly, where it's easy to start a business. And we are not that. But if we take the, again, cut the red tape at City Hall so that they can make it easy to do business, the young people will come back if we improve the quality of life. Yes, we're going to have the jobs, but if we keep chasing jobs and don't change the quality of life, it'll be for naught. Because they cannot live in the city limits.
In the quality of life, the first thing anyone who's not rich has to do, have to get a job.
Say that. That's what any politician would probably say, you want to unite everybody. Well, let me say this. At our Monday morning staff meetings, every Monday morning, there's many African Americans sitting there, as there are Caucasians. We have a former president of the NAACP in Jimmy Gardner, the chief of police at Richard, sitting there, as well as the Tea Party. And somebody says, how do you keep them from killing each other? And I said, it's very simple. It's not about the ideology. It's about identifying the problems and bringing everybody together to focus on those things that we need to do, that we need to do to change our city. And so, I will not be controlled by any party's ideology. I will be controlled by my faith and by my character and by the integrity that my parents, my father's 92 years old, is sitting here today. Those are the things that I will make my decisions based on, not whether I'm a liberal or conservative.
Not being business friendly with the small businesses, the quality of life. education system. The fiscal challenges that we have will never be addressed until we can grow the city and have people living in this in the city limits. And they've got to feel good about it. And I just know that that can change, and it does change a change in mindset, but it only comes about, that change in mindset only starts when you start to see positive examples of things for improvement, and that's got to start in the mayor's office. And once the population or the citizens of Mobile realize that real change is coming to improve the quality of life, then they won't be wanting to leave somewhere else, and that will solve the problems as far as our financial problems, as long as we allocate the money in the right area. I also think that we've got to focus on hiring local companies. You know, years ago, 1985, there was a city ordinance saying that 15% of all city business contracts needed to go to the economically and socially disadvantaged. You know, that is not something that we've been doing. And so recently the city council passed a thing that we're going to do a disparity study. My gosh, the last time we did one was 1991. Why do we have to do a disparity study to recognize that we have not reached out to the minority businesses and given them their fair share of the business that's going on in Mobile? That is something that we have got to do. By doing that, then they will feel a part of the city, and they will help it grow because they are part of the city. Thank you.
Regional significance. And one of those projects they attend because they don't know another option. And when they do find another option, Highway 90, then they block the entire downtown on Thursday and Friday. And we need to address that issue. But I think that one of the key issues for the Restore Act money is environmental mitigation. So certainly those projects will take some priority. I happen to serve on that committee, and I know that the committee has a real interest in that. And there's another part also for the environment that we are not dealing with. So there are a lot of other regional significance projects like that bridge that's for Mobile and Baldwin County, not just for Mobile and Baldwin County, that we need to address. But as of today, no specific project has been delivered to the community. We've not got a project because we've not started accepting projects. We don't know how much money we're going to be getting, and we don't know when we're going to be getting.
This is our last question, and it goes to Mr. Mayor as well. And you've touched on it. It's also by Casey Calloway. How do you propose to handle the stormwater problems plaguing the city of Mobile?
We're in that process right now. We have a stormwater plan that's being implemented that we had to formulate with ADM with the approval of EPA. That plan is in the implementation stages. We are aware of what those issues are. We know we have to address those issues. We are actually spending a lot of time and resources addressing those issues right now, and I suspect we'll continue to address those really for a number of years because we have so many outfalls, and we have to actually do an inventory of all of them and determine what we have to do to make those outfalls work properly and also make sure that they are not running runoff that shouldn't be into the water stream, into the watershed. So that is a project that we have to do. We're required to do it anyway.
Thank you. Now then, we'll have closing remarks. Mayor Jones will go first, and like we've done up until now, he has the opportunity to bank any of his time. You have 3 minutes.
As we're all aware, our city is progressing. It is doing better now than it's done since I've been in Mobile. I hear people talk about the good old days. I was here, I don't know where they were. These are the good old days in Mobile. And we should take advantage of it. We have, and this campaign is not about, and this election is not about promises. It's about performance. It's about what's being done, what has been done. The thing that I'm a big believer in is that we ought to talk about what we have done. And we ought to talk about what our positions have been on important issues in the past. It's a good indication of what we'll do in the future. I think that we need to look at that very closely and look at what has brought us to where we are. If you like what you're seeing in terms of progress, then we have some support out there, right? If you like the growth and development that you see on the horizon in our community, we ask you to support our campaign. If you would like to see every person in Mobile benefit from the growth and the progress that's taking place in this community, that's what our campaign is all about. If you'd like to see us be one of the top cities in this country, based on what we have done and what we're doing. The good thing about checking out records is everybody knows what you've done. Nobody knows what you're going through. And the reason I like for us to check out records is a known fact. We can make our mouths say anything.
Business, I've done it in civic organizations, and I've done it in schools. Looking back,
impact over the last 8 years? I ask you. Is your neighborhood safer? Do you feel safer? Is the quality of life improved in our city or in your neighborhood? And do you really think that City Hall is operating at optimum efficiency? If not, then we are not ready to take advantage of the opportunities that will come with Airbus. And today, I stand ready to lead Mobile from being good to great, to become the safest, most business and family-friendly city in America by the year 2020. If we embrace this vision, then we put a stop to Mobile becoming a city in decline. Just imagine how many lives we will save while we're doing this, how many violent crimes we will prevent by doing it, and how many jobs that we can create through small business growth. Imagine our city where young people don't leave, and where the young people from other communities come here to live because of our quality of life and our jobs. Imagine our city being a place where we can live, work, play, and pray together as one Mobile. We all want beautiful parks. We all want a vibrant and growing arts community. We want roadways with bike paths. And we want to make sure that our infrastructure is not crumbling. So over the next 6 weeks, I'm going to earn your vote. And I would just ask for you to vote for me on August 27th. And in doing so, you will have voted for the person with the most passion and the most commitment that will unite our city so that all Mobileans can be a part of this community.
Thank you.